daytime is prime time on WSNS Channel 44, Chicago. The On Deck Show with Harry Carey is brought to you by H&A Insurance. For car, motorcycle, home, or liability insurance, call the people who live up to your expectations.
Hi, I'm Ted Albrecht of the Chicago Bears, and I'm part of a team 6 months out of the year. But the rest of the time, I'm a businessman, completely on my own. That's why I'm glad I have year-round protection of my H&A policy. H&A gave me good rates, friendly service, and they're there when I need them. So take some good business advice from me and put an H&A broker on your team today.
For car, motorcycle, home, or liability insurance, call H&A today for a quote, 322-2100.
It's a beautiful day for the final game of the 1980 baseball season. Hello again, everybody. This is Harry Carey at Comiskey Park, where the White Sox wind up the season against the California Angels. Our guests on the pregame show will be the second baseman of the Chicago White Sox, Jim Morrison. And I'm going to tell you why he's on this final day of the season. I spent a lot of time going up and down the records, trying to pick out the one man who is the most consistently good ball player the White Sox have had all year long. And I think when you look at it from that perspective, you've got to come to this conclusion. It's Jim Morrison, the White Sox second baseman. You had yourself a fine year, Jim.
Thank you very much, Harry. That's a fine compliment, especially coming from you. It means a whole lot to me.
And you never gave up this year. You knew you were learning to play a strange position. You had to work extra hard to master that to the extent that you have. Still, it didn't affect your desire and determination.
Well, I think, you know, we have a lot of winners on this club, and we have a lot of guys that are what they call gamers. And, you know, it's tough to go out there every day and get beat. And, like, we got off to a good start at the beginning of the season. Of course, after that first month and a half, it was very disappointing. And it's tough to go out there every day. It's very easy to go out there when you're winning and playing real good baseball, and you look forward to going out there every day and playing hard. And it's tough to get yourself up, but we have a lot of guys here that were playing every day and really trying the best they could.
Well, I think that's the sign of the pro, of course, of the real professional ball player, the guy who can give it as much when his team's not in the running as he does when it is.
Well, Harry, you know, you just want to keep going. You want to try to make something bad into something good. And certainly we didn't have a great season this year. It was very disappointing, not only for myself, but for the rest of the teammates and the management and coaching. And, you know, we just want to maybe get back off and maybe hope that we can get started on the right foot next year. And maybe we'll make a few trades that can strengthen the ball club and turn things around so that we'll have a very good club here next year and have some exciting baseball so the fans can really come out and root for us and cheer us on.
Jim, you know, you go down your lineup now and you look at the batting averages and everybody's hitting about what you would expect him to have hit. Yet we know with the pitching that you had that if everybody did do that, that you should have won more ball games. Now, Lemon is up to around 297, 298. You're at 285. Lamar's at his 280. You had yourself an outstanding year, more so than the other guys that I mentioned, only because of your consistency, I thought.
Well, Harry, we've had some guys that we've been inconsistent, as you said. I think that myself included, I've been disappointed in my season because I've left some runners on third base that should have been driven in. It could have possibly changed the course of a ball game. And, of course, over the whole year, you know, all of us, not just one person, contributes to that fact. But the whole team, you know, it's been a big letdown. The pitching's been super. We've definitely got some very fine young arms. And, you know, we just look forward to that fact coming back. And maybe we can get back next year and have a solid infield, know everybody's going to be playing short, third, second base, first base. I think that can't do anything but help us. And maybe we can get back on the right track next year and get everybody going in the right direction.
We're talking with Jim Morrison. Our pick is the ball player of the year for the White Sox, and we'll be back for more following this. Harry Carey back at Comiskey Park, our guest on the pregame show, second baseman Jim Morrison of the White Sox, and we've selected as the White Sox most consistently good ball player of the year. Jim, you spent all this time learning to play second base. What are you going to do now if the White Sox during the winter make a trade, come up with a guy who's always been a second baseman, and move you to third? Would that make any difference to you?
Well, first of all, I think we're going to sit down and talk about it. I hope they just don't make any rash decisions and not consider my feelings or what I've done, tried to put the effort into to become a second baseman. Secondly, I guess if they did that, you know, I'd have to work my rear end off and get back into the habit of playing third base. But, you know, a lot of people always want me back at third, and, you know, I've been playing second base, and it's really funny because nobody around here has really seen me play third base. And not that I'm saying I'm a terrible third baseman, but I'd like to stick at second base if I possibly could.
The only criticism I hear, it seems to me now that you're making all the plays and you're making them well, Jim, but it seems like it's such an effort for you to make them, whereas some of these other guys look do it so easily.
Well, sometimes it looks that way. I guess I'm conscious. I haven't had a very good year in the field, and I've let that bother me. And of course, if something bothers you, you know, you definitely want to try a little bit harder to change it. And you know, I just want to make sure the ball stays in front of me a lot of times, where I have a chance at second base, just pick it up and throw the guy out, and it's no problem that way. So it's been a little difficult sometimes.
You know, I wish that there weren't statistics at all, honestly. The numbers of errors, to me, have been the most ridiculous statistic to keep. What difference does it make if a guy makes an error that doesn't hurt? To me, the only errors that are important are the ones that cost you a ball game.
Well, that's true.
You haven't made many of those, Coach.
No, I'm thanking the good Lord for that. The biggest thing I think is if you make an error, you know, the pitcher or somebody else has to pick the player up. And I think on winning ball clubs, they do that. You know, the third baseman makes an error and the guy goes to third. Well, the pitcher gets the next guy out and they get out of it. But, you know, and the pitcher makes an error and throwing a hanging slider to a guy and he hits it out of the ballpark. And nobody thinks about that. But, you know, and then the teammates come in and they score two or three runs for him to take care of the one that he'd just given up. So I think it's everybody pulling together and helping the other guy that made a mistake and picking that guy up and going on and winning the ball game.
Jim, I was tickled to death to hear that you purchased a home here in suburban Chicago, and you'll be around all winter long.
Yeah, I think I'm going to enjoy it up here. I haven't seen too much snow in my life, but it's going to be very interesting, let me tell you.
Thank you so much, and congratulations on a great year.
Thank you very much, Aaron.
Thank you, pal. Jim Morrison, I don't think anybody can question the fact that he's been the most consistently good ball player the Chicago White Sox have had this season. It's a beautiful afternoon for baseball. And so the last game of the season will not be played in rain or snow, as has usually been Bill Beck's luck. But today it's going to be played under perfect conditions, just as was his night celebrated Tuesday night. You know, we have a special feature coming up, put together by our producer, Mike Torchia, along with Bob Albrecht, Chuck Senkus, and Dick Martin. What they've done is edit highlights from eight seasons of covering White Sox baseball here on Channel 44. Now, this is Harry Carey down on the field, inviting you to see the efforts of these gentlemen. I know you're going to enjoy it. Guests on the pregame show will receive a Baume and Mercier men's dress watch, courtesy of Henry K. Jewelers, who are located at 547 North Michigan Avenue and on the third level of Water Tower Place. There's a long drive, deep right center field, way back. It drops in there. Here comes the winning run. Here comes Carlos. Here's the relay. The White Sox win. And so did Bill Melton.
I stumbled on this photograph and kind of made me laugh. It took me way back down memory lane. I see the happiness, I see the pain. Where am I? Back down memory lane. I see us standing there. Such a happy, happy pair. Love beyond compare. Look at there, look at there. The way you held me, no one could tell me that love would die. Oh, why did I have to find this photograph? I thought I had forgotten. now I'm slipping fast. Oh, back down memory lane. I feel the happiness, I feel the pain. Here am I.
The On Deck Show has been brought to you by H&A Insurance for car, motorcycle, home, or liability insurance. Call the people who live up to your expectations.
WSNS and on TV, Channel 44, Chicago, your Star Time station.
A TV 44 sports presentation. Chicago White Sox are brought to you by the following participating advertisers. Schlitz, the master brewer's brew. It's today's Schlitz. Go for it. Chevrolet and your Chevy dealer. With Chevette, Monza, Citation, and the new Monte Carlo, Chevy's up ahead for 1981. True Value Hardware Stores. True Value, more than just a name, it's our way of doing business. Commonwealth Edison, providing you the power to grow. The Coca-Cola Bottling Company of Chicago will remind you to have a Coke and a smile and enjoy Chicago White Sox baseball. Interlake Incorporated, a Chicago-based company in metals and material handling, sponsoring White Sox baseball for 8 consecutive years. Rusty Jones and the over 2,500 new car dealers who offer Rusty Jones rust-proofing nationwide. Hello, Rusty Jones. Goodbye, rusty cars. And by the Association of Chicagoland McDonald's Restaurants. Nobody can do it like McDonald's can.
It's a beautiful day for baseball. Hello again, everybody. This is Harry Carey and Jimmy Pearsall on this, the final game of the 1980 season. Where has the time gone?
Well, I'll tell you, it's been a long year for me, Coach. I don't know about for yourself, but I'm happy to see some people out here. It looks like we got about 8,000 or 9,000 people, and certainly Steve Trout wanting to get his ninth win if he possibly can. But we'll see some different things in this ballgame, and also may get to play a position.
Yeah. You know, one thing about Steve Trout pitching the final game, he also pitched the first game of the season. He lost to Baltimore.
We haven't given the lineups, Coach.
Harry Carey and Jimmy Pearsall back in the ballpark. Here are the lineups for today's game. For California, Pontek at shortstop. Leading off, Freddie Pontek at short. At second base, batting second, Thon. Dickie Thon at second base. At third base, hitting third, Lansford. Corny Lansford at third. In the cleanup spot is the DH, Downing. Brian Downing, the DH. Batting fifth in left field, Clark. Bobby Clark in left field. In center field, hitting sixth, Miller. Rick Miller in center field. At first base, batting seventh will be Harris. John Harris at first base. In right field, batting eighth will be Kupski. Gil Kupski in right field. The catcher batting ninth will be Donahue. Donahue, the catcher. And the pitcher will be a left-hander, Ralph Botting. For the White Sox, Lemon in center. Squires at first. Baines in right. Nordhagen, the DH. Morrison at second base. There's the ball bunted on the first baseline. And he's an easy out as Squires tags Campaneris, who has replaced Pontek as a leadoff man. Campaneris. There's Trout, who'll be pitching.
Trout is looking to break a personal four-game losing streak, and like Harry was saying, that he lost his first game of the season on opening day against Baltimore. He'd like to win this one to break this four-game losing streak.
Here now is Dickie Thon. Probably playing second base today with Campaneris, a last-minute substitution at short. Thon trying to hit the right field, foul tips for a strike. Fred Spen, the plate umpire. Newdecker at first, Parks at second, Maloney at third. Steve Trout trying for his ninth victory of the year. Curveball a little bit low. The White Sox lineup, Lemon in center, Squires at first, Baines at right, Nordhagen the DH, Morrison at second, Borgman the catcher, Kuntz at left, Bell at third, Cruz the shortstop with Trout pitching. Two balls and a strike. Cool but a delightful day. Now the pitch. Strike over the inside corner.
Well, we're playing in all white today.
There's a pitch foul out of play.
Maybe the last time you'll see these uniforms of this type anyways. One thing about the uniform itself, the players enjoy playing in that uniform. It's very comfortable and it's a good uniform to play baseball in. It's the colors they didn't like.
Two balls, two strikes. What do the color has to do with
I don't know, but
how
I'm
well
just saying.
Play?
I know, but I'm just saying that they just didn't like the colors.
Bobby Knopf, the third base coach, Darren Johnson at first base. There's a high fly ball to right. Baines going way back. Makes the catch over his shoulder.
Boy, Harry, with the wind blowing in, that ball went a long way. It's blowing in from right field. And the little guy hit it a long way. And look at the good jump. And the way he's standing now, he's going to catch it two hands by turning to the side and made a fine catch.
I tell you, the thing that Baines is going to learn with experience when the ball is hit, to run as hard as he can to where he thinks it is, and then turn around to look for it.
We've said that all year. It's just something that it's not easy for him to do for some reason.
Here's Lance for the slow curve is in the first strike call. Because running while looking at the ball, you can't get to it as quickly. Now the pitch, fastball high.
I'm going to explain a theory on that. You pick up the ball, you pick up the wall. That gives you a chance to get a lot of ground. Then you go back to the wall, and you got about four steps, so you don't have so much time to watch the ball.
Here's the pitch swung and missed.
Because your first judgment of the ball gives you the distance.
Two strikes on the ball, two out. Lansford hitting 261. 15 homers and 80 runs batted in. Now the delivery, here it is. Low outside. Jimmy, I picked Jim Morrison as our most consistently best ball player for the year. You argue with me or
yes,
you agree?
I'm going to take Squires.
Two balls, two strikes, swung on. A bouncing ball. Third baseman up. Here's a throw. Bell throws him out. The reason I don't go for Squires is that Morrison has hit 15 home runs and batted 280.
All right, we'll talk about it.
All right. 1-2-3, nothing across. And we go to the bottom of the first. No score.
You pick Morrison.
Harry Carey and Jimmy Pearsall arguing up here as we go into the bottom of the first with no score. He's trying to tell me all the games that Squires won with his fielding.
Well,
we've only won 68.
You're telling
games.
Me how many games he's won with his hitting Morrison now. I can tell you how many games I've seen Morrison blow in his glove. Not only did he make errors, but balls he couldn't get to because he didn't know the position. So I pick Squires because he's definitely a defensive first baseman and get the job done when you put him in there. You feel that Morrison has won games with the bat, so it's a matter of opinion.
One guy played twice as many tie games as the other guy.
Yes, but the guy that Squires is in 130 games, he went in late in the ball game, which is the most difficult time to go in to play defense, and many times got the big play.
Here we go with Lemon to lead it off. First pitch is a curveball low.
Is this a draw? And don't get me wrong, I love Jimmy Morrison. I think Morrison is a super guy and has come a long way.
Here's a fastball high ball to Lemon. Hitting 293 with 11 homers and 51 RBIs. Last year he had 17 homers, 86 RBIs, and hit 318. Now the pitch outside, ball three. But while this year isn't as good as last year for Lemon, this year is better than what you had a right to expect from Lemon because his lifetime average is 285. Three balls, no strikes. Walked him on four pitches.
You try to tell me, Harry, that watching him pop up with men on base time and time again in the third slot and the fifth slot and getting jammed, it's hard to compare what kind of a year he had to last year when he drove in a lot of big runs, I thought, compared to this year.
He drove in 35 more runs last year and hit 318.
Yeah, I thought last year he was a far more valuable hitter in the third and fifth slot than he was this year. He just seemed to save himself when he went up the leadoff. He did a tremendous job, as good as anybody could possibly do.
He's hit about 370 as a leadoff man. Here's the stretch. Here's Squires the pit. He bunts back to the mound. Botting's only play first base for a sacrifice. From Botting to the first baseman Harris. So the White Sox have a man in scoring position. There's the replay on the bunt.
He has one play, and that's the first base.
On this date, 54 years ago, this date in baseball history, October the 5th, 1926, Babe Ruth hit three home runs in one World Series game against the St. Louis Cardinals. He was to repeat the feat 2 years later. A little bit of trivia on the White Sox notes. One out, one on. There's Baines batting 255. He jammed him with a fastball and he fouls it off. Crowd of about 10,000 or so. Hey, what are they doing here? let's look at that again. What happened?
Call the ball a fair ball, I guess. Our friend behind the plate, spin. Now he swings at the ball. I thought that it hit him on the foot. No, it didn't. It is a fair ball.
Well, wait a minute, let's see where it goes. That goes foul.
Now bounces back fair.
Now watch it. Now it rolls fair. That's what happened to it. So Baines is out. There's a fastball, a strike call. Let's see that one again. That's an unusual one.
That's that extra line down there hit something on the line.
Nordhagen, the batter. There's a long drive, might be out of here. It could be off the wall. A run is in. Nordhagen started for a second. I think he thought it was
a home run. Yeah, Nordhagen, who should have been easily on second base, was watching it go out. It was a low breaking ball that he ripped, but it sunk on him. He hit it so hard.
Boy, I tell you, if you're Reggie Jackson, maybe you can stay at the plate and watch it.
Well, Harry, what do you do? Hit four home runs in 4 days and 10 RBIs.
Now that's ridiculous. Even Nordhagen, as slow as he is, should have had a stand-up double. But he's too busy at home plate watching the home run that wasn't. It hit the fence. So he has to be content with a single. And had Dickey Thon not gone to sleep, they'd have thrown him out at first base. Because he had not returned yet. First pitch is high. White Sox out in front, 1-0. Nordhagen. His 59th RBI. Morris in the batter. Low and inside.
Upfield, not too deep in center and right.
There you get a look at the Angels defense. Two balls, no strikes. Now the pitch on the way, here it is. Low and inside, ball three. This Bunting, who looked bad against the White Sox in Anaheim, looks just as bad in Chicago. Three balls, no strikes.
He has not been up long. This is only his sixth start. He got beat last time out against Kansas City, 5-0.
Here's the pitch, swung and he fouled it back. Larson was swinging with 3-0. They're here from Lansing, Illinois, from Whiting, Indiana, from Davenport, Iowa. The Piklanskis are here. They're here from Arlington Heights. Billy Burke and her friends are here. Andy the bell ringer is here. Three balls and a strike. He had a cut. Amen.
Over anxious a little bit. Morrison chased the high ball up in his eyes.
Three balls, two strikes. Jim Morrison waiting. He walked him, ball four. There's one important baseball game today, and that's at Dodgers Stadium, where the Dodgers, with a victory, could turn the National League West into a tie, and it'd be a playoff game at Dodgers Stadium for the championship tomorrow.
Garvey got his home run to win that ball game for him yesterday. He's won 17 game winning hits for them. What a player.
What a clutch player.
Oh boy.
Here's the pitch on the way to Borgman. Strike call. Runners at first and second. Bright sunshine, a beautiful day. Pitch by Bonning. Fastball high and outside. Well, the Minnesota 12-game winning streak came to an end. Kansas City beat them 17-1 last night. The standings in the American League are determined in the West. Here's a base hit. In the left field, a runner's going to score. Nordhagen racing for the plate. Bergman singles to left.
Hey, Harry, Nordhagen rounding third was running downhill. When he rounded first on that ball he hit off the wall, he was running uphill, so he had to stop. Here you'll see it now. This ball is really ripped hard on a line in the left field. The throw is just an ordinary throw to the cutoff, man.
Twice in Anaheim, the White Sox swept three-game series from the Angels. There's Larry Sherry. No, make that it's Jim Fregosa going out. No, that's Larry Sherry.
Sure, Larry Sherry. This program is owned by WSNS-TV through exclusive rights granted by the Chicago White Sox and is telecast solely for the entertainment of our audience. Any reproduction or other use of this play-by-play description in the account of this game without the express written consent of WSNS-TV is prohibited for the last time.
Here's the way they'll finish in the American League West. Kansas City, Oakland, Minnesota, Texas, Chicago, California, and Seattle, in that order. The only doubt in the American League East is for third place, where Milwaukee, Boston, and Detroit are separated only by a game. There's a pitch to Rusty Kuntz, and it's low and inside.
Rusty likes this kind of pitching. He ought to rip this guy.
Line drive off the third baseman's glove. Here's a runner going to score. 3-0. Kuntz lined a single off of Lansford's glove. And now it is 3-0.
Well, we're trying to get this ball is really hit hard. It's up in his eyes. The third baseman Lansford gets a piece of the ball but can't hold it, and he slows it down. If Biden got by, he might not have been able to score as Morrison comes on to score.
Boy, oh boy, you see. You know what a shortage there is. When you see some of these guys in the big leagues. Here's the pitch to Kevin Bell, and it's low into the dirt.
Chris Knapp, who has not pitched much the second half of the season, is warming up in the bullpen now for California.
One ball, no strikes. A pitch to Kevin Bell. Curveball low.
You know, since that trade, you've got a guy like Downing who's been hurt badly, Frost who had a bad back and then took chips out of his elbow this summer, and now Knapp has not been able to pitch much for them, so Dodson's done a good job.
We haven't got much out of him. Here's a pitch swung and foul out of play. Haven't got much out of Bosley.
Well, you know, Harry, I thought we did, though, in the pinch hitting roles early. He was sensational. He did a pretty good job when we were winning. We got three base hits with the bases loaded.
Two balls and a strike.
But when he had to play every day, he couldn't get it done.
Now the delivery. Strike call over the outside corner. Two balls, two strikes. Rusty Kuntz at first. Glenn Borgman at second. The White Sox out in front, 3-0. Ralph Botting, the left-hander pitch. Fouled it out of play. Houston, L.A. at L.A., I think they start 3 o'clock.
There you see Jim Fregosi.
Fregosi is headed for Las Vegas right after the game today.
Oh, really?
There's Tony La Russa, who celebrated his birthday yesterday.
It's been a long year for Fregosi with injuries.
He's not going to go to the playoffs, he said, and he's not going to the World Series. He's going to be operated on for what is that? Diverticular something. Here's a pitch fouled out of play.
Is that pertaining to no pitching?
No, but it was probably caused by it. Two balls, two strikes. Diverticulitis, that's what
there it is. stomach ailment, Harry? Or?
It's like the colon. Two balls, two strikes.
Is that be caused by bourbon?
No. The pitch, outside.
What a beautiful sunny afternoon. Temperature around 55 degrees.
Runners at first and second, three runs in. Here's the pitch on the way. Oh. Hey, struck him out. Bell goes down swinging. Three runs. Three hits. No errors, two left. At the end of one, the White Sox three, California nothing. Harry Carey back at the ballpark. We're going to the top of the second on this, the final broadcast of the year. Final game of the year.
Harry, let's talk a little about the Yankees in Kansas City.
I like the Yankees.
All right, I know you like the Yankees, and I kind of like them too, but you got to remember about the Kansas City ball club. The thing about the Yankees is they're balanced. In their infield, they're not spectacular, but they're balanced. They make the average play. In the outfield, they may be a little short, but they make the average play.
First pitch to Downing is low.
Behind the plate with Cerrone, they're outstanding. They're pitching. You got now a choice of putting Guidry or May in the bullpen.
There's a strikeoff.
I got to believe they'll put May because of Guidry's experience in starting in the World Series. Then you got Gossage down there.
Ground ball hit. Great play by Kevin Bell. Throws him out. Spectacular play. A diving stop to his left by Bell. And a perfect throw.
Boy, Kevin, who hasn't played in a long while, watch him go to his left now and dive for this ball. The problem for him now after he gets it is getting it out of his glove. He has a little trouble, but Downing hit it so hard, he gives him plenty of time. And he throws a strike over there. A good play by Kevin Bell.
One out, that'll bring up Bobby Clark. Swings, and he fouls off the first pitch.
And you got Gossage, of course. But the speed in that KC ball club with Wilson, Brett, White, Washington, and even Otis sort of helps him a little bit. That's what they wanted, and I got to think. And of course, Quisenberry in the bullpen, who you don't know whether he can pitch under the pressure of a playoff.
So what do you say?
I say the Yankees.
Well, I said that in three words.
I know you did, Harry, but I was just trying
we
to give some idea
to
why.
We have a speech, do we?
Well, I was just trying to give
two
a little reasoning
and nothing
behind it.
The pitch, way outside. Bobby Clark. Five homers, 33 RBI.
See, you picked the Yankees all the way anyways, and I wanted to see Baltimore. It was a pretty close, but the Yankees are just too steady.
Two strikes and a ball. Here's the pitch on the way. Lined in the center field, a base hit.
Or should I say they were just too much Gossage in Jackson.
Kansas City has beaten the Yankees 8 out of 12 over the year.
But boy, Harry, in that 3 out of 5 is not too long. It's breaks and experience that really helps you.
The first two games are played in Kansas City, aren't they?
Yeah.
Here's Rick Miller now with a runner at first, one out. The pitch, low and outside. One ball, no strikes. One out and one on. Good fastball over the outside corner. Evens it up at a ball and a strike. Much more intriguing than the playoff between the Yankees and Kansas City, to me, is that ball game today at Dodger Stadium. Now the pitch swung and fouled.
But you know,
a year ago, Houston one time had a 10-game lead after the All-Star break and lost out. Today, the Dodgers can catch him. End the race in a tie with a victory. There's a pitch a little bit low and outside. Who scheduled a pitch that? Necro?
It is Rule for Houston, Welsh for Los Angeles. Mm. It's Welsh is 14-9 and Rule is 11-4. Hasn't he been outstanding lately? Or?
Yes, he has. But you separate the men from the boys on a game like this.
Wow.
Here's the pitch, swung, and he struck him out. Rick Miller goes down swinging.
Trout now has 85 strikeouts. He's walked 44.
Here now is Harris, the first baseman. Curveball a little bit low and inside. 3-0, the White Sox are leading. They're 9-3 against the Angels, trying to make it 10-3 today. They want to do to the Angels almost what the Tigers did to them. Tigers beat the White Sox 10 out of 12 this year, and the White Sox are going for 10 out of 13 against the Angels. A ball and a strike. Pitch is low and away.
Boy, the flags from center field straight in now, about 15 miles an hour from the right side. Yeah, there you see it.
Ball outside. Ball three. Another left-hand hitter, Kubski. Boy, they have three left-hand hitters in a row in this lineup against Trout. There's ball four. He walked him. Gil Kubski, the right fielder.
One thing about it, he's got it all in his favor, Trout, because left-handers during the year do not hurt him. But you got to stay ahead.
Now the pitch. Swings and he fouls it back. St. Louis football Cardinals are murdering the New Orleans Saints. 20-0 in the second quarter. Seattle's taken a 3-0 lead over the Houston Oilers at the end of the first period. There's a strike call. Denver leads the Cleveland Browns 6-3 in the second quarter. Now the pitch. Struck him out. A fastball over the outside corner. No runs, one hit. No errors. Two left. We go on the bottom of the second. White Sox 3, California nothing. Harry Carey back in the ballpark. We go on the bottom of the second inning with Todd Cruz leading off. Speed of recovery to Sam Segbich. Cruz hitting 239, takes a curve in for a strike call.
Cruz, since his knee injury about a month or so, maybe a month and a half ago, has never been the same with that bat. He's been fielding well, though, but for some reason he has not hit well at all.
Now the pitch, here it is. Fastball in there for a strike call. Congratulations to Lieutenant Sherla and his men. They're doing a great job around the ballpark this season. Here's the pitch. He struck him out on a curve.
It's a little curveball that locked him up. See that stance he has there? He's so locked up with his hands behind his neck that he gets locked up with a little curveball.
One out, nobody gone.
Watch it now. Watch how tight it is on him. Watch the funny swing he has. A terrible swing.
3-0, White Sox. George the drummer boy circling the ballpark. There's a long drive hit by Lemon way back. Way back, gonna be caught by Rick Miller. Chet Lemon drove that ball about 400 feet. But Rick Miller made the catch easily. Two up, two down. Here's Squire.
Squire's his first time up. sacrifice, got Lemon over to second base, and then Nordhagen drove him in with a double.
The White Sox open the season at Fenway Park in Boston next year on April the 10th. Two out here, Squires.
Is Fregosi going to be operating in Las Vegas? Is that where they're going to operate?
I don't think so. I think they have a couple days vacation. Here's the pitch. Curve into the dirt.
I think every manager hates to go to the playoffs. It's just really something they don't enjoy. And the reason that they want him there is because of a trade or meetings. They need everybody that they can have to talk to different people on ball clubs.
Here's Squires taking the pitch inside. Two balls, no strikes, two men are out. Ball game in the second inning. Squires the hitter. Harold Baines waiting on deck. There's a pitch a little bit outside. Ball three. Three balls, no strikes. Two men are out. Ralph Botting, the left-hander, is set. Ball four, he walked him.
You know what hurt our division in drawing people, Harry, was Kansas City just jumping out so far. And overall in baseball, for drawing, in the American League, they're minus 388,000 this year. In the National League, 310,000. Of course, there's more teams in the American League.
Here's Baines. He was out on a freaky foul ball. There goes a runner. Strike call, the peg. He's in there with a stolen base. Squires steals second.
Here's the replay now. Ball is right where he likes it, but he makes a terrible throw. Squires easily beats it.
That's his eighth stolen base for Squires. He's been thrown out nine times.
Catcher is Donahue.
Tom Donahue. There's a pitch a little bit outside.
Langsford at third sneaks in a little bit on Baines. Baines has been dropping bunts down that third base line against California's last two series, especially against left-handers.
A ball and a strike. There's a curved line to right center. A base hit. A run is in. Here goes Baines on his way to second base. Kupski fumbled that ball. Call it a double. And a run is in.
Kupski had to run a long way for this ball. Here you'll see a high breaking ball with just nothing on it. Look at it. Boy, he just rips it. If you throw a left-hander a high snake inside, he'll kill you. Kupski can't come up with it. Squires scores. Baines was in a second base with a double. And that is Baines's 23rd double of the year. Baines also had 16 triples and 13 home runs.
49 RBI. Ooh. There's a pitch, goes behind Nordhagen. Ooh. All the way to the screen. Here's a man going to try to score. And he makes it all the way from second base. The pitcher was late covering. Donahue, the catcher. Nonchalant and going back.
Harry, watch where this ball goes over the back of Nordhagen's neck. He threw at him. And boy, I like to see a guy like Baines finally stand on that mound like he still belongs in double A. Now watch where this ball goes. He threw it right behind him. Now, if that isn't a throw at pitch, I never saw one. And now watch where the pitcher is. He doesn't even go home. He doesn't want to face Nordhagen, I guess, but Baines will score easy. That was a real throw at job.
Boy, I won the last day of the season.
I want to tell you, that ball really was thrown at him. If it hit him, it hit him right in, maybe in the neck. A little bit late the way he's pitching. He doesn't have enough to throw at anybody.
Now the pitch, here it is, and the fastball is low.
He's one of the few left-handers I've seen come in the American League in the last couple of years with garbage for a young man.
Green Bay leads Cincinnati 14-6 in the second quarter in football. Two balls, no strikes. And it's outside. 5-0 in favor of the White Sox. Chris Knapp still warming up in the bullpen. Now the pitch. Popped it up. On the infield is the shortstop, Campaneras. Makes the catch to retire the side. Two more runs for the White Sox on just one hit. No errors. Nobody left. At the end of two, the White Sox 5, California nothing. Harry Carey and Jimmy Pearsall back in the ballpark. We're going to the top of the third. White Sox are out in front, 5-0.
It is getting a little chilly, Coach.
As the sun goes down.
Behind the screen.
Tom Donahue. First pitch is high, ball one. Donahue hitting 187. He weighs more than that. There's a fastball for a strike call. A ball and a strike. Tom Donahue, the catcher, swings at a breaking ball. Two strikes and the ball.
Watching Chris Knapp throw in the bullpen, he's pushing the ball. He doesn't look like he's got much velocity at all.
There's a strike called over the outside corner, and he's out of there on strike. Third strikeout for Trout. Trout pitched the first game of the season and lost. Now the last game of the season looks like he's going to win.
Well, the pitch could have been either way, but it's too close to take.
One out.
The last day of the season.
Here's Campaneras. Strike over the outside corner.
Harry, we were talking about a valuable ball player to a ball club. In 1972, I watched this guy play shortstop for the Oakland A's.
Very great. I saw him in 1970 when he hit 20 homers. Can you imagine
that? And you know, Harry, watching him, not only cutoffs, but defense and running the infield.
Here's a pitch swung on and missed.
And starting out a rally in the eighth or ninth inning, you knew he was going to get on when you needed that guy on there. I mean, that's what you look at a ball club. It was just one of the most fabulous years I've ever seen for a...
He was one of the most valuable members of that club.
And you don't think about how big he is or what he was. It's just how good he was.
Two strikes on the ball. One out. The pitch to Campaneras. Fouled it back. Into the stand.
He's the youngest 38 or 90, 41, 2 years old I've ever seen.
This might be the swan song for him, though.
Yeah, I think his contract is up this year.
There's a pitch foul out of play. Into the stand.
You know, this California club has learned to try to fill their shortstop position with an older guy. It's not worked out.
Two strikes and the ball. Fastball low and away.
That's why I wonder why they got rid of Melnick. Because he looked like he had tools, but there again, they see him more than we do.
Two balls, two strikes. Campaneras, the hitter. Swings a ground ball on the first baseline, Squires has it. Over to Trout, covering for the out. Two gone.
Campaneras.
Dickie Thon.
Down that line in a hurry. Now watch. Trout, who really doesn't get over there, forgets how fast this guy is. He just reaches out and, oops. Now watch, Mike gets a little tough play. He has to throw the ball to the pitcher because he can't get it himself. And it looks like there's going to be a little contact here as we get to the bag. No, he got it easy.
Two men are out. Here is Dickie Thon. White Sox shooting for their 70th victory of the year. Here's the pitch. Drill foul. Outside first base into the right field stand.
Thon, who would be about a 275 hitter because he's a contact hitter, he'll fool you with his power for a little guy. He drove Baines onto the track in a long drive his first time up, but Baines had to make a good catch to get him out.
There's a strike call.
In the minor leagues before he came up this year, he was hitting around 390 for about 50 games.
Now the pitch by Trout. A little bit low. The St. Louis Cardinals are leading the New Orleans Saints 30-7 in the third quarter.
Yeah, the only thing the Saints got of a quarterback.
Here's a pitch a little bit low. At Minnesota, Bradshaw just went over. Pittsburgh leads Minnesota 23-3 in the third period. Now the pitch. Stein jammed a little roller to the second baseman. Morrison has it over to first. 1-2-3. Nothing across. We go into the bottom of the third. 5-0 White Sox. Harry Carey back in the ballpark. Max Patkin entertaining the crowd now. Here's a surprising football score. We have Seattle leading Houston now, 26-0 early in the third quarter. Can that be right? That's how it comes through on the ticker.
Chris Knapp comes on. Knapp making his 32nd appearance. He has started 20 games, got one complete game. He's got a record of 2-11. With a gigantic ERA of 6.35. He's pitched 113 innings, got one save. Knapp, who started his career right here in Chicago, went out to California in the trade for Dotson, Bonds, and Bosley. Of course, Frost has been the big pitcher for California in the trade because Knapp has never been able to come into his own. He was unhappy with them, with his salary one time halfway through the season, and really held out, and that got him in bad graces with the Angels, and he never really has come back from that time of the year when he was having a pretty good year.
Here we go. And leading it off, Jim Morrison.
Now you see the clown prince of baseball giving a few signs.
Morrison walked and scored his first time at bat. Deep center field will be caught. Rick Miller calling for it, and he has.
You know, Harry, Morrison likes it so much, he sold his home in Atlanta and has moved up to Lyle area around Naperville.
Yeah, bought a home there.
Yeah.
Here's Glenn Borgman, drove in around with a base hit. I like that question mark.
We got a few of those. Oh, they're throwing
toilet paper out at Patrick. Anybody we know?
The facial expression is what gets me.
Well, he doesn't even have to have an expression. His face is funny naturally. Here's Borgman. And Chris Knapp's pitch is high. One ball, no strikes. There's a fastball in there for a strike call. There's a pitch a little bit low.
He didn't get as many people in the fun run this year, huh, Coach? I didn't see that many.
I don't know. They seem to be. Here's a pitch.
Hey.
I thought maybe we'd catch a foul ball. Max Patkin going through his annex. Here's strike three call. Borgman called out on strike. Henry Cheatham of our one of our cameramen celebrating a birthday here.
44 years old.
Again.
There he is. big guy.
That's the channel number, not his age.
I'll tell you one thing, as big as he is, anything he wants in the barge room is on me.
Here's the pitch now to Rusty Koontz, and he lifts a high pop foul over near the stands, and the first baseman grabs it, Harris, for the out. 1-2-3, nothing across. This is Harry Carey with Jimmy Pearsall. Going to go over to the radio for a little while. The score here at the end of three, the White Sox 5, California nothing. At him there.
Well, you're looking at the clown prince of baseball, Max Papgen, going through his daily routine. Well, he really got drenched there. Apparently some whitewash. I thought they'd thrown some lime out there, but that would be dangerous. Maybe it's talcum powder. It's hard to tell. He'll vary his routine a little bit from day to day. Basically, it's the same. Joe McConnell speaking to you from Comiskey Park as the Sox bid to sweep the final game of the series. In fact, if they sweep the Angels here, it'll be the only series sweep of the year for the White Sox here at Comiskey Park. They swept the Angels three times twice in California. High pop foul off the bat of Carney Lansford. Lands on the roof down the first base side, strike one. Lansford was thumbed out of yesterday's game for objecting to a call strike a bit too strenuously, along with his manager Jim Fregosi. He slaps another foul ball upstairs on the first base side. Two strikes the count. Lansford grounded out to third baseman Kevin Bell his first time up. Sox leading 5-0 here in the fourth. Trout wasting no time. Delivers a bit high. 1-2 the count. Swing and a miss. Lansford fans for the 92nd time this year, and that's 4 Ks for Trout today. His high was 7 against the Yankees in late April in New York when he pitched the first of his 2 shutouts. Here's another look at that swinging third strike. He went for a bad pitch into the dirt. He chased that slider. Brian Downing, he was robbed of a hit by Kevin Bell his first time up. Kevin made a lunging belly flop, gloved his ground ball, got up and threw him out. Fastball strike in the outside corner. Trout's control, for the most part, has been impeccable. He walked John Harris on 4 pitches. Other than that, he's been ahead of every hitter. Downing with that open stance facing the pitcher. Curveball in there, a beauty. 2 strikes. Trout has been the victim of some shoddy fielding by his teammates and himself as well. 20 unearned runs scored off Steve Trout this year has been one of the major problems he has had. That's why his record is 8-16. Outside with a fastball, 1-2 the count. Well, the only really big game left today. Houston at Los Angeles. Into the dirt. 2-2. A win by the Dodgers would force a single game sudden death playoff for the same 2 clubs tomorrow at Dodger Stadium. The Astros went into Los Angeles with a 3-game lead and 3 to go, and the Dodgers down to their final out, bailed out the first ball game, and Garvey's 26th of the year won it yesterday 2-1. Low and inside, now the count is full of Brian Downing. Mike Schmidt's 48th wrapped it up for the Phillies at Montreal yesterday. Carlton was to pitch today, but when the Astros clinch, they're going with the youngster. Bouncing ball to the right side. Morrison over, gloves it right off his right shoe top and throws him out. 2 down. So Montreal will play the winner of the Houston Los Angeles fracas for the National League pennant. And the Kansas City Royals, champions in the West, will play the New York Yankees, champions of the East, beginning Wednesday night. Best of 5 to determine the World Series entrant for the American League. Here's Bobby Clark, who singled his first time up. The only hit off Trout. Outside and out of Borgman's mitt, ball one. The Sox were able to come up with some timely hitting, capitalizing on Ralph Botting's wildness to score 5 runs. Down and in, ball 2 and no strikes. Neither club with an error, although I thought the right fielder Kupski should have been charged with an error on Baines' ball, but they gave Harold a double. Foul back. 2-1 the count. The 2-1 delivered. Ripped down the left field line. Fair ball just inside the line. Bouncing down into the left field corner. And apparently one of the fans reached over the railing and impeded the progress of the ball, so that's a ground rule double to Clark. His 10th two-bagger. Another look. He's got both hits off Trout. Watch down in the left field corner to see if one of the fans reached over and touched that ball. Yep. I don't know why they'll do that. Swing and a miss on a high fastball to Rick Miller, who struck out swinging his first time up. Two out. There's a look at Clark with his lead at second. Broken bat, bouncer to the opposite side under Bell's glove, but Cruz feels it and throws him out. It looked like a tough play. It skidded. It scooted on Kevin, got under his glove, but Cruz was backing him up and made the play to retire the side. No runs, one hit, one left after 3.5 in Chicago. The Sox 5, the Angels nothing. Well, we get set for the bottom of the fourth inning. The Sox will send up Kevin Bell, Todd Cruz, and the leadoff batter, Chet Lemon. What a way to make a living, huh? Kevin Bell struck out in his first time up against the starting pitcher, left-hander Ralph Botting. Now he's facing the former Sox right-hander, Chris Knapp. Inside, ball one. In the bottom of the seventh at Three Rivers in Pittsburgh, the Pirates lead the Cubs 1-0. Inside again, ball two and no strikes. No score in the fifth at Cincinnati, the Braves and the Reds. New York Mets lead the St. Louis Cardinals 1-0 in the fourth at Busch Stadium in St. Louis. Blowing away, 3-0. No score posted yet on Philadelphia at Montreal. The Dodgers hosting the Astros in a must-win situation in Los Angeles later on. Strike, the automatic, 3-1. The American League, they're in the fifth at Boston. Toronto swept a twin bill from the Red Sox, leading today. Blue Jays 2-0 over the Red Sox. Kevin Bell hammers one high and deep left center field. Long run for Rick Miller, and he reaches up there to glove it. The wind helped hold that one up. Kevin gave it a good ride. There's Todd Cruz, who struck out his first time up against the departed left-hander, Ralph Botting. Try to read those signs. Blown away, ball one. Tell you, that looks easy till you try it. Hapkin has played in 70 different ballparks this summer. He's been doing it since the 40s. Foul back, 1-1 the count. He and Bill Veeck go back a long way. Outside with a slider, 2-1 to Todd Cruz. Tell you, you need a rake and a shovel when he gets done showering. swing and a miss on a pitch up around the shoulders. 2-2 to Todd Cruz. A drive to left field, but Clark over in front of it makes the catch for the out. Two down. Two well hit balls, but right at the outfielders here. Now Chet Levin, who's walked and scored and flied deep to Miller in center. 0 for 1 for Chet. Had he been able to come up with a couple of hits yesterday, would have had a real shot at making the 300 mark, but he was 0 for 4 yesterday. It's only the second time in 35 games that Chet failed to reach base one way or another since he was moved into that leadoff spot. Breaking ball into the dirt. Ball one. Stake at the knees. 1-1 the count. I think we reiterated earlier, Papkin one time called time. He'll sometimes call time and walk down to talk to the batter. He did that up in Toronto when Mayberry was up. Walked down and had his little conference with John, and Mayberry hit the next pitch out of the ballpark. High drive left field, but it's hit too high, I think, to get out of here. Into the left field corner, chasing it in foul territory, and what a catch! Oh, man! What a play! That is the second great foul ball catch in this series by Bobby Clark. Let's take another look at that. Boy, what a great catch. He stayed right with it, right into the first row. The Sox go down in order. Mr. Clark is quite an outfielder. After four innings here in the south side of Chicago, the score, the Sox 5, the Angels nothing. Plate. And of course running to third. George Bologna is kind of a ham himself. He hasn't called it yet. He hasn't called it yet. Look at Marvis Foley in the Sox dugout. They're loving it. They usually throw him out of the game. I don't think he threw him out. That's Bobby Knopp, the Angels third base coach. Oh, Max Papke gets a nice hand. I'll tell you, that's hard work. He is to baseball what the Globetrotters are to basketball. He's been to practically every major and minor league ballpark in America at one time or another in the past 35 years. Come over to congratulate him. He's too dirty to touch. John Harris leading off the Angels fifth takes a pitch inside a ball. Ball one. 5-0. The White Sox behind Steve Trout have the lead here. Trout's given up two hits. Both the Bobby Clark, who just turned in a fielding jam a moment ago. Ball two and no strikes. Harris will be followed by Kupski and Donahue, the bottom third of the Angel batting order. He takes a strike, 2-1. I'm happy to say the health is much better today. Beginning to wonder whether he's going to make it yesterday. Good fastball, strike two, 2-2. Ever have those days where you want to die? I had one of those yesterday. He's out of there. Call third strike. That's five for Trout. Three of them have been called third strikes. So Harris, who walked the first time up, the only walk off Trout, looks at a call third strike, and it's a beauty. Fastball, knee high outside corner. Perfect pitch.
Hey,
Kupski takes a ball. He struck out looking his first time up. Kupski and Harris were both brought up along with the starter today, Ralph Botti, on the 1st of September for the Angels. Pitch outside, ball two in those strikes. Trout needs another strikeout to reach the 90 mark for the year. He has 89 at the moment. He missed again, 3-0. He walked him on four pitches. That's the second walk issued by Steve and his 46th of the year. One on, one out. Here's Donahue, struck out. He looked at a called third strike, a slider, his first time up. There's five in a row. Trout has missed a strike zone with, and Borgman goes out in front of home plate to settle him down a bit. I think he needs to slow down just a bit. Well, the A's in the bottom of the fourth at County Stadium, leading the Milwaukee Brewers 4-2. Yesterday, Bob Lacey, their left-hander out of the bullpen, got a start and pitched a shutout. Inside a ball, that's 2-0. Now Borgman calls time. He's going out to talk with Trout. That's six in a row Steve's missed the strike zone with. The Blue Jays leading the Red Sox 2-0. Bottom of the sixth at Fenway. They won a pair from Boston yesterday. Kansas City, the Royals leading the Twins 3-0. Top of the fourth at Royal Stadium. There's a strike, 2-1. Last night, Kansas City ended the Twins 12-game losing string, and boy, did they ever. 17-1. Yankees leading Detroit in the fifth at New York, 2-1. Drive to center, Chet backing up. Now comes in, makes the catch, 2-0. Now the leadoff batter, Bert Campaneris, who was put into the lineup at the last moment. They had penciled in Freddie Patek, but when the game started, Campaneris was in there. Tried to butt his way aboard, tagged out by Squires in the first inning. And he hit one right off the end of the bat that Squires fielded behind the bag and flipped to Trout to make it a close play in the third inning. He bunts again right in front of the mound, picked up by Trout, and that retires Campaneris. So he's had a variety of putouts involving the pitcher and the first baseman. No runs, no hits. One left. A brief look at 38-year-old Bert Campaneris. After 4.5, we reached the halfway point here in Chicago. The Sox leading the Angels 5-0. Mike Squires will lead it off. They'll be followed by Harold Baines and Wade Nordhagen here in the bottom of the fifth inning. Chris Knapp, who's pitched two innings in relief for the Angels. Well, I'd personally like to thank every one of the very talented people who have made my first year in Chicago so very easy to do here on TV 44. Outside the ball. We'll miss a lot of these guys. Friendships are made in this business. But after 8 years, WSNS, of course, changed format, and that necessitated some programming changes. 1-1 to count to Squires. Most of the fellas I see more than some of the others. Outside a ball in the changeup, 2-1. Jimmy Angio, Mike Torsia, Bob Jacobson, all of our camera crews here. Nice bunch of guys to work with. I'm sure most of them will be bumming around Rush Street with their hands out. Foul back, 2-2 to Squires. Yeah, maybe Madison Street or South Wabash. They won't be able to afford Rush Street. Two balls, two strikes to Squires. Bouncing ball to the right side. Glove behind the bag by Harris. He'll make the play and assist it. One out. Mike had sacrificed, walked, and scored, so he is now 0-for-1. Harold Baines, a ground out, an RBI double, and a run scored. 1-for-2 for Harold. the Sox can hang on to this lead, they'll wind up with a 70-90 record, which for some strange reason looks a lot better than 69-91. Kravick up and throwing again. High pop fly, shallow left. Clark coming in. Campanaris going out. Clark calls for it and takes it for the second out. That's eight in a row retired by Chris Knapp, although some balls have been hit hard. Now Nordhagen, who singled in a run and scored in the first inning. The lead holds up. Nordy will get credit for his 10th game-winning RBI of the year, which would tie him for the team lead for 1980 with Lamar Johnson, who has 10. Nordy popped up to short his last time up, so he's one for two. Outside the ball, ball one. Foul back, one and one. Jake's getting in practice already. He's got his cup. You better clean up your act, Jake. Inside, ball two and strike one. Guys down at the Cook County Jail. Get a berth ready for Jake. He may be in there later. Nordy's hit, but inside pitch. Take another look. Knapp steps by way of third base and throws about three quarter. That pitch just drilled Nordy in the left shoulder. Looked like it was just above the left elbow. Two out, Nordhagen on. That brings up Morrison. Jimmy trying to extend his hitting string to 10. He has hit safely in 9. Had 15 of the last 16. He walked and scored in the first. He flied to center his last time up. Right under his chin. Ball one. Morrison's been nicked with a pitch 8 times this year. Chet leads the league with 12. That was the first time Nordhagen's been hit by a pitch all year. Just inside, fastball, 2-0. Two outs, Nordhagen on at first, we're in the bottom of the fifth. Ball three up high. It looks like Jimmy will finish third in the American League in doubles with 40. First half of the year, he was leading the league, but Yount surpassed him, and so did Al Oliver's having a great year with the Texas Rangers. Ball four, he walked. First walk issued by Knapp, and the fourth given to the White Sox. Botting the starter walked three, including Morrison, in the first inning. So with two out, the Sox have a threat with Morrison and Nordhagen on base. Here comes Fregosi, not to have a word with Knapp, who had retired 8 in a row before he hit Nordhagen with an inside pitch. I'll make that Larry Sherry. Sherry looks a lot from a distance like Jim Fregosi. Sherry, of course, as White Sox fans will always remember, was the outstanding player in the 1959 World Series when the Dodgers beat the White Sox 4 out of 6. Sherry saved all 4 Dodger victories and was the most valuable player in the series. Now a youngster by the name of Schuler, David Schuler, begins to heat up in the Angel bullpen. They left about 7 pitchers back in California. Didn't even make this trip. Here's Borgman, 2 on, 2 out. We're in the bottom of the fifth. Sox already leading 5-0. High drive center field. Miller camps under it, shading his eyes with his glove. And that retires the side. No runs, no hits. A walk and a hit batter. 2 left after 5. The White Sox 5. The Angels nothing. In the top of the sixth inning, the Angels will send up Dickie Thon, Kearney Lansford, and Brian Downing, the numbers 2, 3, and 4 hitters in their batting order today against left-hander Steve Trout, who's coasting along right now with a two-hit shutout. Thon has flied deep to right and bounced to Morrison at second. Outside, ball one. The Astros failed to score in the first inning at Los Angeles. Inside the ball. Ball two and no strikes. The Expos have taken a 2-0 lead in the second in Montreal over the Phillies. This one, of course, a meaningless game. Ball three and no strikes to Thon. There's a strike, 3-1. Apparently over at Pittsburgh. Pirates win the season finale with the Cubs 1-0. The Cubs will wind up with 98 losses this year. Ball four, Thon is on. Third walk given up by Trout. Pass along some football scores for you here in a moment. Four hitter at Pittsburgh for Don Robinson. Doug Capilla lost it. Only RBI of the game, Bill Robinson. Strike called to Lansford, who has bounced out and struck out. A smash in the hole skips past Cruz out into left field. The Angels have a threat going with runners at first and second, nobody out. Lansford singles sharply to left in the hole. He becomes the second Angel to get a hit off Trout today. Two on, nobody out, and that'll bring up Brian Downing, who was robbed of a hit in the second inning by Kevin Bell at third, and then bounced out to Morrison the next time up. In the middle of the fourth quarter in Philadelphia, the Eagles have a 24-14 lead over the winless Washington Redskins. Well, they've been a major disappointment. The St. Louis Cardinals are embarrassing the troubled New Orleans Saints 40-7 late in the fourth. Strike to Downing. Early in the fourth period at Atlanta, the Falcons 43, the about to be defeated for the first time, Detroit Lions 13, 43, 13. The Falcons over the Lions. The Steelers were leading the Vikes the last time we looked. Green Bay and Cincinnati were hooked up in a close game. The Bears, of course, play tomorrow night in a must-win situation against the Tampa Bay Buccaneers at Soldier Field. The first of three straight division opponents for the Bears. They'll be up at Minnesota the following week and back here to face the Lions. Two Sundays from today. Strike called inside corner. Two strikes on Brian Downing. Gary Danielson just hooked up on an 80-yard touchdown pass to Leonard Thompson. That makes it 43-20, Atlanta over the Lions in the fourth period. And Baltimore now beating Miami. The Colts 30, the Dolphins 17 in the fourth period. Schill has pulled out a couple of miracles earlier this year. Two strikes, the count on Downing. Just outside of ball, 1-2 the count. Angels runners at first and second, nobody out. Almost hit him. One ball and two strikes to Brian Downing. Baltimore leading Cleveland 2-1 in the fifth at Baltimore. If Baltimore wins it, they will have won 100 games this year to finish second in the East. The Yankees clinching yesterday. Fouled off. They're now in the seventh at Yankee Stadium. The Yankees leading the Tigers 2-1. Tony La Russa finishing his first full season as a big league manager. That's Bobby Winkles in the jacket. Looks like he's freezing. Jim Fregosi on top of the hill a year ago. smashed to left, base hit by Dowling. They're going to wave in. Dickey Thon, here comes a throw. They cut it off. Runners at first and second, and a run is in. It's now 5-1 as Dowling drives in his 25th of the year. And the Angels' first three batters here in the sixth inning have reached. So the shutout is gone. Here's another look. Still nobody out. And here comes the skipper out to have a word with Trout. Kravick has been throwing. And now Mike Proley gets up and starts to heat up. So it's Kravick the left-hander and Proley the right-hander in the Sox bullpen. 5-1 now. The Sox leading here in the top of the sixth. There's a look at the two pitchers warming up. Still nobody out. Runners at first and second, and Bobby Clark, who is singled and doubled, due to step in against Steve Trout. Rather lengthy conference is now finally broken up with the home plate umpire Fred Spinn. We're again glad to say that Bill Veeck, who just looked marvelous yesterday in great spirits, he and his wife Mary Frances attending the final game of the year here today. They were here yesterday as well. There's a ball outside, ball one. The two runners take their leads. Ground ball is short, should get two. Morrison for one, double play. And for the White Sox, their 169th of the year. A big double play there. That takes the teeth out of the inning. Moving to third is Lansford. But now there are two out. One on, a run in. Cruz taking that hot smash off the bat of Clark to Morrison, who returns to first for the double play. Now Rick Miller, who was struck out and bounced to short. Hard ground ball to Morrison. He gobbles it up. Throw to first, and the inning is over. So Steve Trout settled down thanks to the big double play ball. One run on two hits. There was a walk and one man left. We head for the bottom of the sixth in the final game of the year. Sox 5, Angels 1. Sox leading the Angels, trying to take their only sweep of the year here on the home ground. Rusty Koontz will lead it off. He has singled in a run and popped up in a foul territory to the first baseman. It's a high drive left field. It's deep, near the wall, and it's caught by Bobby Clark. I didn't think it was going out of here, but it got a little deeper than I thought. Rusty bidding for his first home run of the year. Gave it a good ride. Let's take another look at Clark, who's been busy out there in left field. Never gave up on it. Wind held that one in. On a calm day or with a little push from the wind, that ball would have been in the lower deck. Kevin Bell has fly deep to center and struck out on his two previous at-bats. Ground ball right to the shortstop, Campaneris. Comes up with a knee-high bounce, and he throws him out. Two down quickly here in the bottom of the sixth. Well, again, I'd personally like to wish good luck to all the television side here on 44. Well, thank you. I'm talking off mic, as you might well imagine, with Jimmy Angio, who calls a lot of the shots from the truck here. Well, it's been a fun year. It could have been more fun had we won a few more ball games. That just wasn't to be. Low ball one to Todd Cruz, who has struck out and lined to left. The Sox dugout. There's Lamar Johnson with his jacket on. Danny Krieger, the exercise weight coach. Foul back into the upper deck. The ball and the strike to Todd Cruz. Nice catch by one of the fans. Breaking ball inside. Ball two and strike one. Five to one. Sox leading the Angels. Trying to take their only sweep of the year here on the home ground. Rusty Kuntz will lead it off. He has singled in a run and popped up in a foul territory to the first baseman. It's a high drive left field. It's deep. Near the wall. And it's caught. By Bobby Clark. I didn't think it was going out of here, but it got a little deeper than I thought. Rusty bidding for his first home run of the year. Gave it a good ride. Let's take another look at Clark, who's been busy out there in left field. Never gave up on it. Wind held that one in. On a calm day or with a little push from the wind, that ball would have been in the lower deck. Kevin Bell has fly deep to center and struck out in his two previous at-bats. Ground ball right to the shortstop, Campaneris. Comes up with a knee-high bounce, and he throws him out. Two down quickly here in the bottom of the sixth. Well, again, I'd personally like to wish good luck to all the television side here on 44. Well, thank you. I'm talking off mic, as you might well imagine, with Jimmy Angio, who calls a lot of the shots from the truck here. Well, it's been a fun year. It could have been more fun had we won a few more ball games. That just wasn't to be. Low ball one to Todd Cruz, who has struck out and lined to left. At the Sox dugout, there's Lamar Johnson with his jacket on. Danny Krieger, the exercise weight coach. Foul back into the upper deck. The ball and the strike to Todd Cruz. Nice catch by one of the fans. Breaking ball inside. Ball two and strike one. Fly ball to right. Kupski under it. And there's a third out. So the Sox go quietly against Knapp, who's pitched hitless shutout ball in relief since he came on in the third inning. So we have completed six innings of play here on the final day of the year. The White Sox leading the Angels after six, 5-1.
Carry back to the ballpark. We're going to the top of the seventh inning. Jim Harris will lead it off. The White Sox are out in front, 5-1. Now the wind up, the pitch swung and he fouled it in the stand. Well, this is our last telecast on channel 44. As you all know, they will no longer be carrying baseball. They've already or on pay TV at night. I tell you, our association has just been a great one. You couldn't run into nicer people than the band, the crew here. Ed Morse, the vice president, general manager, who's become a good friend, starting right at the executive level. So many of the people back at the station we don't run into, but we're so important in making the telecast possible. But the guys we have here that we have gotten to know and more or less live with, enjoyed so thoroughly down through these past 8 years, I would be remiss indeed. There's a ground ball. Great play by Kevin Bell. Throws the first for the out. Beautiful play. A diving stop and a perfect throw. Watch it again on our replay. He leaves his feet right here.
Now look how he can get up and get something on his throw. One out, nobody on. There's a fastball in there, a strike call. Mike Torchia, Jim Angio, and Bob Jacobs up here in the booth with me. There's a pitch foul back. They not only are masters of their craft, but they're just magnificent people to be around and to enjoy. And I'm happy to report in all sincerity that that's exactly what we've done with them. Laughed with them, cried with them, argued with them, fought with them, dined with them. Except when Torchia was around, he never picked up a down. It's a pitch lined in the left center, a base hit. Kupski singles to left. All our cameramen, too, I want to make sure I mention them all. Kurt, who stays on TV. Mendelson. Henry Cheatham was celebrating a birthday. Bob Albrecht. Mark Clausen. There's Kurt. And there's Henry Cheatham. How about Mark Clausen? On our audio, Kevin Reynolds. Our engineers, John Thomas, Bill Fuller. Our technical supervisor, Pat McGowan. John Dickinson. Here's a fly ball hitting the right field for an easy out. Baines takes it. Two gone. There's Clausen out in center field. I think you've seen shots of some of these guys on the tube today. They wanted to prove they're handsome. It's amazing what they can do to make guys look better these days. Two men are out. There's Bert Campanera. There's a fastball low. All our advertisers, we want to thank. Here's a pitch, a little tap, foul off to the left. Howard Kaplan and the gang from Henry K. Jewelers, who presented our giveaway gifts to the players. Couldn't be nicer people than that. So, here's a pitch a little bit high and outside. I hate to see anything in, but here's a pitch outside. But then when it does end, it's nice to know that you have the feeling of friendship that I have for all these people. Three balls and a strike. There's a bouncing ball to Kevin Bell. He's got it. Oh, with a first for the out. We're going to bottom of the seventh. The score remains. The White Sox, 5. The Angels, 1. All right. Let me hear you. Hey, this is for Bill Beck. Sing it loud. Here we go, Nancy. Everybody, take me out to the ball game. Take me out from the crowd. Buy me some peanuts and Cracker Jack. I don't care if I ever get back. Oh, it's root, root, root for the White Sox. If they don't win, it's a shame. For it's 1, 2, 3 strikes, you're out at the old ball game. And the crowd is giving him a standing ovation. Minnie batted yesterday, took two balls with a two-ball count. He swung at the next pitch and fouled out. There's the windup now, the pitch. Last ball in there for a strike call. Minnie Minoso. the third baseman. He'll be out. Look at Minnie run down that line at 58 years of age. Dave Schuler is the left-hander on the mound now for the end. Listen to the crowd. He really hustled down that line. I think he can beat some of the players right now running to first base. Minnie Minoso, there's Orlando Cepeda. I'd like to see, there's Herman Schneider, the trainer. So Lemon's season is over. Chet Lemon went out for a pinch hitter, Minnie Minoso. Mike Squire's the batter. Long drive, cuts deep back. Two gone. You had a shot of Francisco Barrios a moment ago. Hey, Nancy, I'm sure gonna miss you. Nancy Faust. There's Francisco Barrios. This is Dan Traeger alongside them. There's a pitch swung on by Baines. Pop fly, here comes Campaneras. Makes a fine play. Baines popped to Campaneras, who made a great running catch. There you get a good look at Nancy Faust. Have a good winter, Nancy. At the end of seven, it remains a White Sox 5, California 1. Jimmy Pearsall back at the ballpark as we go into the eighth inning. For California, Dickie Thon will lead it off.
Coons is going to center field and Sutherland is going to left. I didn't tell you the other day, but I'm going to get it in today.
Houston has taken the lead 2-0 over the Dodger. Here's the pitch now. It's a little bit inside.
You know it wasn't a home run, didn't you?
Yeah. Oakland leading in Milwaukee 4-2 at the end of sixth.
Ooh.
Whoa, there's a smash. Look out. Cruz hey. Throws him out at first base. Let's see if Trout is hurt. Deflected by Trout to Cruz to throw him out.
He like hit his glove hand. Shook up his wrist.
No, I think it hit above the glove, Jimmy.
Well, okay, let's see. He really ripped it. This ball is creamed. Now watch.
See, oh, boy, right on the
wrist part
wrist.
Of it. Yeah, like the glove part in the wrist. It hit both. And watch Cruz with that arm.
So it's 1-6-3 if you're scoring.
You know, it's very scary. No one realizes how close you are to that mound unless you've pitched the ball to a hitter. It can get there before you can blink an eye. And that little round ball hurts.
The New England Patriots have defeated the New York Jets 21-11.
How about Seattle?
Philadelphia Eagles beat the Redskins 24-14. And how about Green Bay leading Cincinnati 14-6 at the end of the third quarter? Lansford, he's 1 out of 3.
You know, I gotta believe that California feels that they can't beat us. Somebody can't beat us.
I have a feeling they don't much care one way or the other. Final score, Baltimore 30, the Miami Dolphins 17. There's ball four to Lansford.
The most fascinating thing about the California Angels this year, in sixth place, they have drawn about 2,300,000 people, and that has got to be some kind of a record. I don't care what anybody tells me. I've heard of the Detroit when they finished last would draw 1,000,002 or something, but this is ridiculous.
Pittsburgh Steelers knocked off the Minnesota Vikings 23-17. Here's Downing the pitch. Strike call. One strike or nothing. A nippy day. Base hit like a bullet. Boy, it's a good thing that Trout deflected that first line drive into an out, because he now has walked Lansford, and Downing ripped a single up the middle, and that will bring up Bobby Clark. Clark hitting to a double play in the sixth.
After two line drives by Lansford and Downing, Clark hit a ball harder, but it was right at the shortstop.
So here's Steve Trout delivering. Fastball outside.
Proley warming up in a bullpen. Farmer has gotten his 30th save, so he seems to be very happy with that, but if they need him, I imagine he can pitch.
Hopped it up. Squire shading his eye. Two men are gone. That'll bring up Rick Miller. Miller's 0 for 3, but an easy out three times in a row. Mike Proley limbering up on the bullpen.
I would have to say Proley has been a very valuable piece of merchandise for this team. Long relieving, short relieving, mopping up, never complaining, spot start.
There aren't too many guys in this ball club that I would give a race to.
But
Mike Proley is definitely one.
Proley has gotten it. He's been in 61 games, so you know your record always doesn't tell how valuable you are to a ball club. He's got an ERA of 3.09.
One ball, no strikes on Miller. Swings and he slices it foul. That evens it up. A ball and a strike. Coach, it's been a long, tough year.
Coach, my thanks for your loyalty to me.
Here's the pitch, a little bit high.
I know I'm your problem child, but I love you. And I say thank you very much.
No problem.
I hope we do it again. I hope the world doesn't.
I wish we could have won a few more games. Yeah, that's right. Two balls and a strike. A little bit low. Three balls and a strike.
You know, the honest truth about this team, Harry, a couple of average players here or there would make this team at least an enjoyable team to watch. We're not that far away from a ball club that could be enjoyable. I ain't saying how much we're going to win, but to be enjoyable.
There's a base hit down the third baseline. Here's a runner around third racing for the plate. Leo Sutherland's throw comes back into the infield. And it's a 5-2 ball game now as Miller got around late and poked a single right over third base. Now here's Harris, a left-hand batter.
Getting cold.
Walked, struck out, and rolled out.
We started cold, Coach, and we'll finish it cold.
But we started with a loss, and we're going to wind up with a victory, I hope.
This is the guy he's got to get. He's got him 0 for 2 this afternoon.
Here's the pitch low and outside. You know what you just said about just pretty steady ball player, not necessarily a star. There's a line drive going to be caught by Sutherland in left field. He's got it to retire the side. He had him played perfectly. So it's one run out of all that. Two hits, no errors, two left. We go to the bottom of the eighth. 5-2 White Sox.
Jimmy Pearsall and Harry Carey on the last day of the season. We're in the bottom of the eighth inning. White Sox are leading 5-2. Nordhagen's going to lead it off. First time up, Nordhagen drove in a run.
Yeah. Well, the White Sox went over the 1,200,000 mark. 1,200,365 for the year. Today, the paid was 8,795. Art Hagen takes the pitch outside. Bottom of the eighth inning.
Sure, the pitcher. Bunting started, relieved by Knapp.
Schuler, a left-hander. Now the pitch, here it is. There's a long drive and a left center field going to be caught. That wind holds the ball up, and Bobby Clark makes the catch.
There's been a lot of balls hit today.
Mary Frances Vick saying hello to some of the fans. Greetings to our friend John Seward, one of the White Sox great fans. Fine sponsor on the telecast. One out, nobody on. Here's Morrison. One strike and nothing.
There he is. Seward.
Seward in the skybox, I guess. There's a pitch popped up, foul, and out of play.
I want to thank the ladies on the switchboard all year who took my messages, and Harry's and everybody for being so patient with us. And to Millie Johnson, great job she does in the ticket office.
That she does.
Super.
Two strikes and nothing. He struck him out. Morrison goes on swinging. You don't want to overlook our great friend up here at the press box level, Joe Panatti. The Andy Frame people.
I agree with you, Dave. The hardest working guy I've ever seen in my life.
He really
any
is.
Any question or doubt. He doesn't want anybody unhappy, and that's including every fan that drives him crazy down at that door.
Two men around. Here's Borgman. Glenn Borgman, the hitter.
I try to give him some of my pills some night, but he doesn't want them.
Two strikes and nothing. The season is about to end here in Chicago. Well, let's see. The Cubs lost 98.
There's Rosie.
There's our great traveling secretary, Glenn Rosenbaum.
Bob.
Along with Bob Finnegan, who's the PA announcer. Borgman hits a fly ball to center field. Miller is there and makes the cut. 1-2-3, nothing across. Well, when do you want to go to Notre Dame?
I will call you.
All right.
Okay. Enjoy it. Thank you. Have a nice
winter. See you later, Jimmy. At the end of eight innings, White Sox 5, California 2. We've mentioned Joe Panatti to you, and here he is. Here's the man who's brings all these programs up for autographs, the pictures, takes care of all the fans. Joe, you do a marvelous job around this park.
Glad, Harry's a pleasure to be working with you and all the Vick family. One of the five best years I've ever worked. I've been around the ballpark for about 60 years from the time I used to sneak into this ballpark when I was a little kid. This has been really a great pleasure working with you and everybody here.
Well, thank
really
you
an
very
honor
much,
and
Joe.
A pleasure.
Good luck. Take
okay,
care of
Harry,
yourself.
Good luck. All right.
Okay. We're in the ninth, Kupski. Bouncing ball, headed for left field, and it's a hit. Kupski opens the ninth with a ground single to left. Ed Farmer was in the bullpen warming up a moment ago. Rich Dotson's been limbering up. Rich Dotson's going to go on a baseball trip to the USO, with a lot of other star players. Tom Donahue, the catcher, the batter. Line in into center field to hit. Hey, they got something going here. Runners at first and second, nobody out. Here's Bert Campaneris. The score, 5-2 in favor of the White Sox. The White Sox over the past 5 years now have averaged $1,300,000 per year. There's Tony La Russa, the manager of the White Sox, coming out. In the fourth period, Seattle leads Houston in football 26-7. Yankees beat the Tigers 2-1 today. Baltimore's going to win its game. Baltimore will end the season with 100 victories, but will have finished second. Runners at first and second, nobody out. Outside. The Rams have taken a 7-0 lead over the 49ers in the first period. Atlanta knocked off Detroit 43-28. Low ball three. Three balls, no strike. Strike call, the fastball. Dickie Thon is on deck. Mike Crowley's down in the bullpen. 3 balls and a strike. Strike two call. Campaneris thought it was high. The home plate section now is in the shadow of the stand. So the sun is, the pitch is coming out of the bright sunshine into the shade. The Baltimore Orioles last year in winnings had 102 victories. This year in losing, they had 100 victories. 3-2 pitch. All four, the bases are loaded. Nobody out. That's going to be all for Trout. He's going to leave with the bases loaded, nobody out. And Mike Crowley is going to be coming in out of the bullpen. This is La Russa's second appearance of the inning, so. All right, we have a new pitcher coming in, Mike Crowley. A nice hand going up for Steve Trout. Listen. We'll be back following this message. Mike Crowley taking his practice tosses. One of Bill Veeck's records was just broken today. In 1948, the Cleveland Indians under Bill Veeck set an all-time American League attendance record, which until this day had never been broken. But today, the Yankees broke it when they drew almost 36,000 paid, running their attendance for the year to 2,627,417, beating the attendance record formerly held by the Indians under Bill Veeck in 1948. Mike Crowley with a chance to pick up his eighth save. reappearing in his 62nd game. He's won 5, he's lost 10 with an earned run average of 3.09. He's got 7 saves. White Sox have made only 4 hits today, but have 5 runs. Jason Thompson is going to bat. Left-hand hitter. Thompson hitting .288 with 21 homers. Fastball a little bit low. Bases jammed, nobody out. Low ball 2. Low and outside. Nothing pitch. Swung and he fouled it off. Jason Thompson was going for the long one. Houston leading the Dodgers 2-0 in the third, in the game deciding the last remaining spot in the playoffs. Philadelphia's in the National League. Houston must win to get in. The Dodgers could force a playoff with a win. It's New York and Kansas City in the American League. Ball 3 low. 3 balls and a strike. The Angels about hit the White Sox 9-4, but the White Sox lead 5-2. 3 balls and a strike. He had a cut and he fouled it off. And the count is full at 3-2. Bases loaded, nobody out. Crowley trying to make him hit the ball into a double play. 3 balls, 2 strikes, the count. Jason Thompson, a long ball threat. 3-2 pitch. Bouncing ball up the middle. They may get the double play. Save at first, the run is in. Just got the force out. Morrison unassisted. That makes it 4-3 now. 5-3, rather, did I say 4? Runners at first and third, one out. A run batted in for Jason Thompson. Kupski crossed the plate. Donahue went to third. Campaneris was barely forced. Morrison's throw to Squires was just too late. Bobby Grinch is going to run at first base. He represents the tying run over there. Here now is Corning Lansford facing Mike Crowley. Strike over the outside corner. One strike and nothing. Crowley going for his 8th save. Fastball a little bit low. One pitch. Outside, ball two. Two balls and a strike. Brian Downing would be up there next. Now Lansford steps out of the batter's box. Ball low. And now it's three balls and a strike. 5-3 in favor of the White Sox. Runners at first and third, one out. Swung at the pitch and he fouled it off. He might have chased a bad ball. Three balls, two strikes. Crowley very coolly rubbing up the baseball off the mound on the grass. There's Jim Fregosi, the manager of the Angels. 3-2 pitch. Bouncing ball foul. Bobby Gritch was holding up, was not running on the pitch, which is a little surprising. He represents a tying run. Baltimore about to win its 100th game of the season, but to no avail. They'll finish second with 100 victories. 3-2. The pitch, there goes the runner. Strike three, the play. Sox win. A double play and a strikeout. So the White Sox have won the ball game 5-3. And Crowley picks up his eighth save. Lansford called out on strikes. And Bobby Gritch thrown out from Borgman to Morrison. Oh, the season is over. And the White Sox ended with a victory. We'll be back with the totals and highlights following this message. Harry Carey back at Comiskey Park. The banners are down all over left field. And Nancy Faust has already played Auld Lang Syne. And the baseball season in Chicago has ended. The White Sox have won the final game of the year by the score of 5-3. The very first game they played here at Comiskey Park this season, they opened the season against Baltimore, and they lost 5-3. The losing pitcher on the season's opener against Baltimore by that score was Steve Trout. And the season's winner by that same score in this final game is Steve Trout. So he won the final game by the very same score that he lost the first game. Here are the totals. 5 runs, only 4 hits, no errors for the White Sox. The winner, Steve Trout, ending the season with 9 victories and 16 losses. Mike Crowley picks up the save, his 8th of the year. For the Angels, 3 runs, 9 hits, and no errors. The loser is Ralph Botting. That's the second time the White Sox have beaten him. He winds up with a record of no victories and 3 losses. So, Jimmy will have his post-game show coming up in just a moment. Well, what is there to say? This is it. I certainly want to thank you wonderful, wonderful people for your friendship and kindness and affection down through these years. I really appreciate it, and who knows what the future will bring. Without a doubt, this is the greatest baseball town in the world. And if ever fans have earned, have paid their dues for a winning and for a championship baseball team, these fans right here at Comiskey Park have done so. Ed Morris, you're a sweetheart of a man and just a great television executive. In your pay TV venture, as well as your regular TV during the day, I know you will continue to enjoy the great success you've always had. And if you are watching today, I just want you to know that this crew that you started doing baseball, what was it, 8 years ago, Jake? They are as good a crew as there is anywhere in this great United States of America. That not only are they talented at their craft, but they are wonderful human beings. And what a pleasure it has been to have the opportunity to work with them and for you. I only wish that success on the field would have matched their efforts on the television. That is it. Another season is down the drain. The White Sox have won 70 and lost 90. And to Bill Veeck, I just cannot believe, and I refuse to believe, that anybody of his competence in baseball, a man with so many original ideas, I just don't believe, I think he is kidding us, I really do, that he is going to be out of baseball. I look for him to either continue in some capacity with the Chicago White Sox or with some other team in the major leagues. Because baseball can ill afford not having a man of his skills involved. For me, I love you. So long, everybody.
Turn out the lights. The party's over. They say that all good things must end. Call it a night. The party's over. And tomorrow starts the same old thing again. What a crazy, crazy party. Never seen so many people laughing, dancing. Look at you, you're having fun. But look at me, I'm almost crying. But that don't keep her love from dying. Misery, cause for me, the party's over. Turn out the lights. The party's over. Must end. Call it a night. The party's over. And tomorrow starts the same old thing again. Once I had a love undying. I didn't keep it, wasn't trying. Life for me was just one party and then another. Broke her heart so many times. Had to have my party wine. Then one day she said, sweetheart, the party's over. Turn out the lights. The party's over. They say that all good things must end. Call it a night.
Chicago White Sox have been brought to you by the following participating advertisers. Schlitz, the master brewer's brew. It's today's Schlitz. Go for it. Chevrolet and your Chevy dealer. With Chevette, Monza, Citation, and the new Monte Carlo, Chevy's up ahead for 1981. True Value Hardware Stores. True Value, more than just a name, it's our way of doing business. Commonwealth Edison, providing you the power to grow. The Coca-Cola Bottling Company of Chicago, bottlers of Coke, Tab, Sprite, and Fresca. Have a Coke and a smile. Interlake Incorporated, a Chicago-based company in metals and material handling, sponsoring White Sox baseball for 8 consecutive years. Rusty Jones and the over 2,500 new car dealers who offer Rusty Jones rust-proofing nationwide. Hello, Rusty Jones. Goodbye, Rusty Cars. And by the Association of Chicagoland McDonald's Restaurants. Nobody can do it like McDonald's can. A TV 44 sports presentation.
This game is copyrighted by the Chicago White Sox.
Daytime is prime time on WSNS Channel 44, Chicago.
It's time for the Baseball Report Show. Baseball Report is brought to you by your greater Chicago area Toyota dealers.
Life a little easier. I've had bad days, but thanks to them, they've helped me. And let me tell you a little bit about what's turning around a little bit. Yeah, this is my show today. I've had your show all year, but you know, you wonder what it takes to learn a little bit about broadcasting. Well, let me tell you, it takes a lot. I certainly need a lot more education about it, but these fellas who knew the TV end of the game helped me tremendously. And my guest on my right today is Mike Torsia, and then the other side is Mike Anjo. And let me ask you this now. I am so sore from this neck. I think somebody hit me when I wasn't looking.
Where
again.
Your band?
I took it off. Just a little bit bulky right now. Let me ask you this now. What has baseball meant to you in the last 3 years? You know, it's been baseball, and Harry Carey and Jimmy Pearsall.
Well, there is baseball, and then there is baseball. And to work with the Chicago White Sox, I think, after all these years has been a dream.
When you say a dream now, when did you start in this kind of work, and how did it come about?
Well, just from contracts that WSNS has signed, well, with sports, concerning sports. We were lucky enough 8 years ago to just simply air the games. We had nothing to do with the production end.
8 years ago?
Eight years ago, yeah.
Boy, it's been a long time, hasn't it?
Oh, boy,
and these two gentlemen in the truck have been, like you said, 8 years, and to you right now, it's got to be something of memories, because where do you go from here?
Make me an offer.
Make you an offer. What have you really learned about baseball since you've been around it? Anything that you'll have memories on?
I think
oddities.
No, I the people in baseball, people like you that have made up the game for as long as I could remember. I mean, there are characters in this game that you just don't find in other facets.
When I'm talking about learning, though, I'm talking about learning. When you're in that truck, you've got to push those buttons and make defensive plays and offensive
Jim
plays
tell
and,
you that,
and things that really make the game go.
Well, we've learned, I think, the most thing is that fortunately we're able to work with people like you and Harry. Harry's been doing baseball longer than Michael and I have been alive. So we've once, just alone in that, that was a learning experience. With you and all your years of playing professional baseball, you've given us countless tips as to what to key on. And through that, it's helped us make the telecast and complement the pictures to match what you're saying much better.
See, the first thing I had to learn, I got up in that booth, and I didn't know where I was or what I was doing. And I think that having you fellas tell me things in my ear, and certainly my trying to relay things on to you are so important. And maybe to many people watching, they don't realize that you can get awfully mad, you get awfully hot, you get frustrated. And guys like yourself, that it take time to adjust to roll with the punches, right?
Sure, absolutely. Yeah. That's the name of the game. Just don't let it snowball.
Now, in your job, the cameramen, so vitally important. How do you keep in touch with these guys at all times?
The cameramen are our eyes. If we don't see the play on the field, it's because our cameramen, I think, are super.
Who
They're
are
the
they?
Best. We've got Kurt Mandelson, who hasn't missed a game since we started here. We've had Henry Cheatham, our first base camera. We've had Jack Walsh, Bob Albrecht, Mark Clausen, Gary Meager, Buzz Harris, just a great group of guys over the last 3 years that have really been our eyes.
The last 3 years, we've lost a few and gained a few. A couple of the old fellas have gained the experience, and they've just done the job for us. Actually,
I think the camera, that fifth camera, made a big difference in the replays, didn't it? Huh? We had five cameras, then went to four cameras for replays.
Oh well, that was an excellent. Oh, what we call a color shot. That just gave you the interesting view, the field level that you don't normally get in most ballparks.
You know, if you wonder why I have these fellas here, I love them both very much because I was so scared. You know, I played baseball and knew all about what went on in center field and on the field, but to know what goes on in that truck and what goes on up in the booth is something that you have to listen. And I drove them crazy with questions, and I think when we did get excited about something, we had meetings.
I remember those meetings.
My favorite line was, if Harry and I got mad, just in 5 minutes it's over with.
Well, that's
or the other line was, a little confusion's always good.
And it's like working with the two of you is really like beating your head against a brick wall. It feels so good when you stop.
We'll be right back right after this message. Jimmy Pearsall back at Comiskey Park. The White Sox won their final game. These two guys have been talking about the truck. You know, that truck is awfully big out there. Now, Channel 44 is going to cable TV. Looks to me like you fellas feel that there's something in sight for you somewhere else, but are you going to stay with 44 for now?
Well, we...
I think
I need a paycheck every week that... allow me to stay at Channel 44, well, yes.
And what I'm talking about, you know, you did hockey before and different things.
Well, they're allowing all the contracts to slip, so.
Oh, yeah. I see. Okay, now, what do you want to do out of life? Are you the kind of a guy that wants to travel around with ball players, or do you want to get involved with news, or what kind of work do you want to get involved in?
I think that both Mike, speaking for Mike and myself, I like to stay with sports. It's something that I've played all my life, and I've played sports all my life through college. And this is, to me, you know, being 28, this is a dream come true. I never expected to be doing something at this young of an age and to be able to work with a crew like this and an announced team that was so good. You know, I want to continue doing sports.
You know, we work for a guy named Ed Morris. Now, let me tell you something about Ed Morris. I've known this man now for 4 years, and when he wanted to get my tail, he got me and sat me down and let me know what was going on. And I hope that whoever you work for, you'll always have that same kind of a guy because you then know where you stand. Also, when things got awfully tough for me, he was one guy that stood right there with me. He was 100% behind me, and if he felt that I was wrong, he would tell me. And to Ed Morris, the only thing I can say to you is, Ed, it's been a pleasure. I thank you from the bottom of my heart for just making me feel like that I was wanted. And that's one thing I think everybody that works anywhere wants to feel that they're wanted. I think it's so important. We can all feel so.
Yes.
So to you and your lovely wife, many long years of happiness, and I just gotten married. And as far as your tennis goes, I will always whip you.
I don't even know where to bring that
up. Even though you are older than me, I don't care. You give me that 1 minute shot. Now, do you fellas want to say anything further? We got 1 minute.
You're asking me.
You want to say anything further about what our year?
Our 3 years of working closely with this ball club have been probably the best 3 years I've ever spent in this business.
See, it's hard for me to ask you questions about your business because I'm a jock. When it comes to talking about guys, it's sliders and sinkers and long catches. But
that's it.
My real feeling about watching you work out in the tread is it just fascinates me because there's so many cameras.
Well, that's
there,
why so you ask us, taking the opportunity just to say thank you to that studio crew. You see everybody work their rear ends off around here. Well, there's an entire studio crew that deserves a whole lot of credit that you don't see, that just has been a backbone to this entire to the entire broadcast.
As you would say to me, you got 10 seconds.
I'd like to thank Ed Morris and Rich Plotkin and Bill Veck and his wife for having the faith and confidence in our crew and giving us the opportunity 3 years ago to do the production. And from all of us to all of you, thank you very much.
Well, listen, ladies and gentlemen, from me, I thank you for your support. Boy, it's been a tough summer for me, believe me. But for your support has really, I could cry. It made me so happy, your letters and your telephone calls. And I certainly hope that you get the baseball team that Chicago deserves next year, a team that will give you some respectable baseball. I think it may happen.
and I'm looking forward to seeing you again. I don't know where, but look in your paper, the listings of your next TV show for baseball. Please check your local listing for time and station for your next televised show. And I'm Jimmy Pearsall, and want to say to Harry Carey, I love you. Bye-bye.
Guests on the Baseball Report Show will receive the rechargeable Eltron Interstate Shaver by Braun AG, featuring a compact cover unit that's a combination travel case with wall bracket, charger, and cleaning brush. It's from Henry K. Jewelers at 547 North Michigan Avenue and on the third level of Water Tower Place.
In my life, I've been wondering why. Still, somehow, I believe we'd always survive. Now, I'm not so sure you're waiting to hear one good reason to try. What's left to provide? You think that maybe it's over, only if you want it to be. Are you gonna wait for a sign, your miracle? Stand up and fight. This is it. Make no mistake where you are.
This has been the Baseball Report Show. Baseball Report has been brought to you by your greater Chicago area Toyota dealers.
There's a long drive, deep right center field, way back, way back. It drops in there. Here comes the winning run. Here comes Carlos. Here's the relay. The White Sox. And so did Bill
Melton. I stumbled on this photograph. It kind of made me laugh. It took me way back, back down memory lane. I see the happiness. I see the pain. Where am I? Back down memory lane. I see us standing there. Such a happy, happy pair. Love beyond compare. Look at there, look at there. The way you held me, no one could tell me that love would die. Oh, why did I have to find this photograph? Thought I had forgot the past. Now I'm slipping fast. Oh, back down memory lane. I feel the happiness. I feel the pain. Here am I. Back down memory lane. I'm in the sunshine. I'm in the rain. Thought it was over. Here I go. The way you held me, no one could tell me that love would die. than the speed of sound.